My name is Bruce Herman. I'm the chairman of the art department, and I'm a stand-in this afternoon for Tal Howard, director of the Center for Faith and Inquiry. And he sends his welcome. He's delayed in Houston. His flight is not going to get him back in time for the talk. So he wanted to extend his own greeting and thank you for coming. It's my distinct pleasure tonight to be the one to introduce our distinguished lecturer in the Hansen Lecture Series. Her name is Dr. Katie Kresser. Katie is Associate Professor of Art History at Seattle Pacific University. She received her PhD from Harvard University in 2006 and earned her MA from Harvard in 2001. Took her BA from Indiana University in 1998. Dr. Kresser's research focuses upon theory and philosophy of art with a special emphasis on issues surrounding the rise of modern art in the 20th century. Her historical and critical work has appeared in American Art, the Journal of the Smithsonian American Art Museum, and the Arts Quarterly Image Journal, as well as Scene Journal, the Christians in the Visual Arts Journal, and Christian Scholars Review. Her book, The Art and Thought of John Lafarge, Picturing Authenticity in Gilded Age America, is a deeply insightful portrait of the artist as faithful servant and contemplative seer. Dr. Kresser will be speaking to us this evening on the topic of art and faith in the great master tradition. Please join me in giving a warm Gordon welcome to our distinguished guest lecturer, Dr. Katie Kresser.
Thank you very much, everyone. I'm so flattered to be called distinguished. That's so nice. Yeah, well, thank you. I'm so happy to see so many people turn out, and I hope that this is a rewarding experience for all of you. But yeah, so let's see. I got this new clicky thing that I'm figuring out here. All right. So I am Dr. Katie Kresser from Seattle Pacific University. I wanted to tell you a little bit about myself before I get started, mainly that, yes, I am an associate professor of art history at Seattle Pacific University, and also I am the only professor of art history at Seattle Pacific University. I think this is not an unusual thing for a Christian liberal arts college to have one or zero art historians on faculty. I think that's kind of true of Gordon as well. But it's kind of a blessing in disguise because it means that I have to teach all of the art history classes at my institution, really, from about cave painting to contemporary art and then some global art as well. And this forces me to be a big picture person. And I'm kind of naturally a big picture person anyway, so this is kind of nice. It's like candy for my brain that I have to teach this wide range of classes. So that's what I do day to day as an instructor. I teach in a big picture way. I teach a huge range of things. Then as a researcher, I have a specific area of study, which is late 19th and early 20th century art in Europe and America, but mostly in America. And as a researcher, I have to have a smaller view. Those two things can really complement each other. And what I hope to do in this lecture today is kind of start with a smaller picture view in one place at one time, late 19th century America, early 20th century America, and see if there are some principles maybe we can derive from some of the specific things we see historically going on at that moment. So starting small and then expanding out, that's kind of what I hope to do a little bit today, seeing if we can find principles in this small historical moment. So the image that I have to show you today, just right off the bat in my first slide, this is called Nosegay of Chrysanthemums by the artist John Lafarge, who was a Catholic Christian artist. You will find as the talk progresses that John Lafarge is going to be featured very prominently, kind of as Professor Herman indicated. This image by Lafarge, it's from relatively early in his career. And I hope this is a digital reproduction on this kind of flat, shiny screen. And hopefully this will come through to you guys. But there's kind of a richness and a presence and almost kind of a pungency to this image, I think. There's a fullness, a wholeness, almost kind of a juiciness to this picture of flowers right here. That sense of presence that John Lafarge lent his objects, the objects of his contemplation, had to do with his faith approach. There was something about his faith that enabled him to get this kind of richness out of his subjects. And so we'll talk about what that means a little bit later. The title of my lecture, The Surprising Muse, Reflections on Art and Faith, ambitious title, I guess. People have been reflecting on art and faith for hundreds of years. This is just One thing I'd like to add to the conversation, I guess, is what John Lafarge's solution was to the problem of art and faith in late 19th and early 20th century America. And, I have the clicker. I was going to go back and advance the slide manually. So I just want to add to, here we are in the late 19th and early 20th centuries, and this is a time of a lot of turmoil. This is a time of a lot of change. This is a time when traditionalism and modernism are clashing. This is a time of a lot of political upheaval all over the world, and this is a time of rapidly changing technologies as well. So I think there's something about this historical period that we can learn from that kind of harmonizes, resonates, I guess, with what we're going through today in the early 21st century. So I definitely think we can learn from the past in this regard. This was a period that was rather like ours in some ways. All right. Yeah, so here we are at the late 19th and early 20th centuries. We're at the intersection of two dynamics. And this is how I'm characterizing them, and this may be a little surprising. But on the one hand, here we are, turn of the 20th century. On the one hand, we have the old master tradition. I'm kind of exemplifying the old master tradition with this beautiful Madonna by Raphael. Raphael at the time is considered to be the greatest old master artist. I think nowadays we tend to think of Da Vinci and Michelangelo before we think of Raphael, but Raphael's kind of the top of the pyramid at this time in the late 19th century, so he's the one everyone looks to. So we have this old master tradition lingering. It's actually still going strong in the late 19th century. A lot of us don't realize this because we tend to think, when we think of the late 19th century, we think of the Impressionists or the Post-Impressionists. Everyone's heard of Monet and Van Gogh. Actually, those artists were relatively obscure compared to artists still working in the old master tradition, many of whom we haven't heard of today. Their names have kind of been lost to history. But these old master artists were really the most famous artists of the day in the late 19th century, and their work was what was getting the most press and the most favorable critical reviews, and they were getting the most commissions for like big civic buildings and churches and stuff like that. So this tradition is going strong. This is kind of the official art style of the time. And then kind of conflicting with that, growing out of that in a way, or more accurately kind of rejecting that, I guess we could say, is the modernist revolution, which I have kind of, my paradigmatic image here for the modernist revolution is Barnett Newman's Who's Afraid of Red, Yellow, and Blue? Just this very abstract picture. I almost said image, but it's not even really an image. It's red, it's got a stripe of blue, it's got stripes of yellow on either side. It's very pared down, it's very simple. Maybe it's very elusive. It could be even confusing. I don't know what many of you guys think of this high modernism right here. But this kind of exemplifies for me where art is beginning to trend around the late 19th, early 20th century. It's beginning to trend in this direction. Meanwhile, this is sort of the official tradition that it's beginning to break away from. So these are clashing dynamics right here. I mentioned John Lafarge earlier. He's who wrote about this is the what my book looks like right here. I think there are probably copies of it sitting around here somewhere. I don't know. Maybe they're out there. There's one right there. John Lafarge stood at the intersection of these two dynamics right at its nascence. Right when these two traditions are starting to split off from each other, that's where he's standing right there. He's right in the thick of it. And he has both of these options, and he has to decide which way he's going to go. A little digression. Most of you probably have not heard of John Lafarge. Has anyone in here besides Professor Herman heard of John Lafarge? Ah, look at that. Okay, a few people. That's good. Yeah, that's good. If you've heard of him at all, I'm thinking you guys are living in the Boston area right now. I would say in the Boston area, Lafarge is probably best known, probably most known to people for his work at Trinity Church. I don't know, has anyone been to Trinity Church? Anyone here? Copley Square in Boston? Yep, a lot of people. Yep. Major landmark in the center of Boston. Very beautiful. Neo-Romanesque building by H.H. Richardson. Lafarge did the interior decoration. This picture is a little deceptive because Lafarge did not actually design this apse right here. This came later. But right up here, we can see his kind of a sense of his vision for the interior decoration of this building with this rich red color as serving as a background for these monumental kind of classical figures. And then we see up here this kind of checkerboard or alternating colors for the arches. So this is a very rich aesthetic environment. It's vibrating with color. He wanted it to vibrate with color. And it's bringing in elements of Christian tradition as well with these monumental figures. And this kind of approach, it's kind of reminiscent of like Romanesque Italian stonework up here. But yeah, so this idea of richly decorating an interior with these monumental figures, but in kind of a modern way, ended up being very influential. And so Lafarge's interior decoration here actually inspired much more elaborate interior decorative programs like the one at the Library of Congress. And has anyone ever been in here in the Library of Congress? A few people? Yeah, just very elaborate, these amazing murals, all in this kind of classical tradition. But yeah, this is, for some people, this is maybe what Lafarge is best known for. Yeah, but I mentioned before, and I'm kind of getting back on track a little bit, Lafarge sits at the intersection of this sort of splitting off, this departure of the old master tradition and sort of the modernist revolution. He's sitting right at the nascence of this, like I said. And so these are some more period-appropriate images here a little bit, representing the early modernism right here, the modernist revolution. I have a picture by James McNeill Whistler, who I think most people have probably heard of. His most famous picture is Whistler's mother, which is that lady who's sitting in profile, and she has on a black dress, and she looks very stern. How many people are familiar with that? You've seen Whistler's mother? A lot of people, yeah. This was actually Whistler's most notorious picture. During his time, this was the picture he was most famous for. Nocturne in Black and Gold, The Falling Rocket. He was most famous for this picture because a famous British art critic, John Ruskin, said that this picture was tantamount to flinging a pot of paint in the public's face. Flinging a pot of paint in the public's face. It just looks like a big splash. It looks like a splatter. Ruskin couldn't even really tell what was going on, and this was offensive to him. This was confusing to him. This is an early, very abstract painting. It's confusing people with its abstraction. I don't know if you guys can tell what's going on in the picture. Yeah, but we actually have, maybe you guys can see this. We have the shore of the River Thames right here. We have a figure standing on the shore. We have the water of the river right here. We have the Houses of Parliament right back here, and you can barely see them. I think maybe even sitting out there, you might not be able to see them. And then this kind of splatter of paint that Ruskin was referring to is they're fireworks. They're the embers and the smoke from a dying firework. So it's fireworks over the River Thames. Incidentally, Whistler ended up suing Ruskin for libel when he heard that remark about flinging a pot of paint in the public's face. And there was this long, protracted lawsuit, and both Whistler and Ruskin lost a ton of money on it. Whistler technically won, but he was awarded one farthing in damages. So it was kind of, it was a joke. The public was making fun of it. The judge himself was kind of even making fun of it by awarding one farthing in damages. But nevertheless, it kind of set the tone for this debate between more traditionalists like Ruskin and then modernists like Whistler over here. So we have something being kind of launched on the path of high modernism right here over here. And John Lafarge and Whistler were quite acquainted with each other. They were friends. And then over here, the lingering old master tradition, we have a picture by Elihu Vedder from the Library of Congress that just looks very classical. The figure is very monumental, muscular. It kind of reminds you of the figures by Michelangelo on the Sistine Chapel ceiling or something like that, but just very, very traditional. And then we have Lafarge sitting here in the middle. He's not really totally going one way or the other. His paint application here is kind of painterly, it's sketchy, it's brushy, it's atmospheric, which was kind of a modern thing to be doing. He's a bit adventurous with his colors here. This picture has a strong, almost kind of Japanese design sensibility, which was a very modern thing. And yet it's still anchored on the human figure, and it has these serene, dignified figures that have kind of a classical grandeur to them, I think. So he's kind of trying to hold on a little bit to this, and trying to embrace some techniques that come from this tradition as well. So he's right here in the middle. He's conflicted, maybe. He's trying to figure out what art should be. What am I doing? I keep wanting to. Okay. I'm used to, in my classes, walking from my screen back to my console, flipping to the next slide, and then walking back. So that's what I keep doing. So we have these two sides. We have the modernist dynamic on the one hand. We have the old master tradition on the other, here at the turn of the 20th century. And these two sides are aware of each other. They are antagonistic toward each other. They're kind of jealous of each other in a way. And they have their intellectuals on both sides who try to justify why their position is the best, why their chosen artistic style is the best one. I'm generalizing here, and not all artists who subscribed to these styles would completely agree with being categorized under one of these two, phrases up here at the top. But nevertheless, you have to generalize for brief lectures like this one, so that's what I'm going to do. So we have these modernist artists starting with Whistler and then moving into the early 20th century, and they're justifying what they're doing more or less by saying that they're searching for a cosmic language. When they reject sort of optical fidelity to reality, what they're actually trying to do is find something higher or deeper, something transcendent of visible reality, something cosmic. We could think of it like the music of the spheres or something like that. And so we have an early quote by Whistler where he says that the artist paints as the musician gathers his notes and forms his chords until he brings forth from chaos glorious harmony. So Whistler does think that art should be like music, visual art should be like music in the sense that it should be abstract. And he's also viewing the visible world, the created world outside of him, as something chaotic that needs to be distilled or boiled down or abstracted into something simpler, something more spiritual, something less chaotic, something better and more beautiful, I guess, something more cosmic. A little bit later, artists like Vasily Kandinsky are going to run with this. Kandinsky was a theosophist, which was kind of a New Age religion. I don't know how many people have heard of theosophism in here. Theosophism purported to combine the best of all of the previous world religions into one pure religion that had like just distilled everything out of the old bad ones into one new good one, sort of. And that's a little bit like what Kandinsky is kind of trying to do with his art. Kandinsky believes, that there are sort of divine correspondences between certain lines and certain colors, and he is intuiting those divine correspondences. He's shooting his soul up into the air, his mind up into the air. He's contemplating the cosmic forms up there, the pure lines and colors. He's finding out what those divine correspondences are, and he's transcribing them in paint in a way that's relatively indifferent to the actual visible created world outside of him. So he's trying to speak a cosmic language. So this is one way the modern abstract artists try to justify themselves. Meanwhile, we have our adherents to the old master tradition over here, who are justifying themselves in a different way. I have a little quote here from Kenyon Cox, an American artist, who suggests that artists should paint their figures as if they are in Eden. Paint your figures as if they are in Eden. Paint an improved reality. Paint your human beings as if they have not fallen, basically. The purpose of art for Cox and for others was to give the public a view of reality that was better than the actual thing, that sanitizes reality, and that can kind of lift our minds up out of the murk of reality into something better and more perfect, something pre-fallen, something almost heavenly, like millennial, I don't know. Just something better than actual reality. So the old master tradition purports to improve reality. The modernist tradition, if tradition is even the right word, purports to kind of transcend reality and give us something more cosmic, replace reality with something more spiritual. John Lafarge, our Catholic Christian artist, who we started out with and who I focus on in my book, John Lafarge is looking at these options, and he very carefully, through his artwork and through his writings as well, starts to articulate a third way for artists to act, for artists to be in the world, for artists to be modern and fresh and creative and authentic, without falling prey to either of these kind of false, hardened kind of extremes, I guess. So a third way, so for Lafarge, art does not transcend or transform, it receives. So the modernists might argue that art should transcend. It should transcend the physical and tap into something more kind of cosmic. For the old master adherents, art should maybe transform. It should take the physical world and it should make it into something more beautiful than reality, stronger than reality, more perfect than reality. For Lafarge, yeah, art should do neither of those things. It should receive. And this gets maybe a little difficult to grasp, but this picture, which is one of my favorites by Lafarge, and it's on the cover of the book, is just irises and the trunk of a dead apple tree and some grass and then another kind of trunk of a tree in the background. And this picture, I think, has a very meditative quality. I think we get the sense that Lafarge has really contemplated his subject here. In a way, he's been passive before it. He's been open to its dignity, and he's tried to bear witness to that. So he's tried to receive. He hasn't used his brain or his spirit, I guess you could say, to modify what he's been contemplating, but instead he tries to kind of receive the essence of what he's contemplating and then just put that back out there for other people to recognize. So for John Lafarge, I think art actually is a relatively, art making is almost kind of a passive process. If we go back to this slide, it doesn't try to extract. It doesn't try to mold or transform. It just tries to be open. It tries to be passive, in a way, open before the witness of reality, and then bear witness to that. And so I have a quote that I think helps explain that process a little bit better. John Lafarge is acknowledged to have anticipated the thought of Jacques Maritain, who was a very influential Catholic philosopher and also aesthetician in the early and middle 20th century, and I think even later into the 20th century, actually. Because Maritain was a bit more succinct than Lafarge, I decided to pull in a Maritain quote here rather than a Lafarge quote. But this is a nice Maritain quote here that I think really sums up what Lafarge was trying to get at in the late 19th century. And so here Maritain says that true art comes from the interconnection between the inner being of things with the inner being of the human self. And maybe that sounds very abstract and kind of confusing, but it's the interconnection of the inner being of things with the inner being of the human self. And what this kind of presumes is that things have an inner being, which I think is kind of interesting. We have an inner being that is sort of beneath and behind the merely empirical. And all of those things out there that we observe, the trees, the flowers, the pond out here, the grass, all of those things have an inner being as well that go beyond or beneath, that goes beyond or beneath what is merely empirically observable. It goes beyond or beneath what we can see with our retinas and what we can take apart and analyze scientifically. So all things that God created, really, they have this inner being. And it's through almost kind of this collision between the inner beings of things that the artwork emerges. It kind of explodes out of that collision. It bears witness to that collision. And so this artwork for Lafarge, I think, kind of sums up his process, the Muse of Painting. It's unusual. A Muse of Painting picture, they usually don't look quite like this. Typically, there is a male painter and a female muse. And it's interesting to me that Lafarge chose to combine those two figures into one. And so we have a female painter, which is an interesting choice. But as we see here, unlike most painters and paintings about paintings, she's not leaning forward and analyzing what she's painting. She's actually leaning back a little bit. Her head is back just a touch. And her eyes are closed, which is quite strange, actually. Her eyes are closed. So she has this passive kind of receptive posture, and her eyes are even closed, which kind of cues us into the fact that the actual object of her contemplation as an artist is not really a visible thing. It's not an empirical thing. It's something that goes deeper than that. And then when we try to descry, I guess, what it is that she's contemplating over here, that's kind of hard for us to see as well. It seems kind of veiled by these vines. And I think think that's significant as well, because I think what Lafarge is trying to point out, again, is that fundamentally what artists contemplate, and maybe what all of us contemplate in a sense when we try to be really open to the world, is not sort of the optical sensation of things. It's something that goes beneath. It's something that underpins the merely visual. And so the fact that the object of her contemplation is visually hidden from us is kind of significant. It suggests that what she's contemplating is something deeper than that. So his Muse of Painting, kind of his manifesto a little bit, I guess. So I think some tenets arrive from this idea that art explodes out of this interconnection or this mingling of the inner being of things with the inner being of the self or the knower or the artist. And one big thing is that art should be anchored on the physical world, because our primary means of knowing is through the incarnation. I think Lafarge's art theory is intensely incarnational. For him, I think it was just kind of anathema to adopt an artistic style that tried to purge itself of the physical and tried to leap off into cosmic realms of abstraction. Because for him, the physical world was so pregnant with meaning, was so imbued with divine meaning, that art just had to bear witness to that. That was kind of the call of the artist. That was the artist's responsibility. And if we think about this incarnationally, this is Lafarge's Christ in Majesty window from Trinity Church. If we think of this idea of, like, in the incarnation, God kind of injects himself into reality and takes on human form and makes physical form kind of proportionate to the divine in a sense. That has big implications for how we contemplate creation. I think Lafarge imagined this kind of trickle-out effect or the spill-out kind of effect where through the incarnation, it was not only the human form that was imbued with divine meaning, but it was other things as well. The entire creation attained a kind of dignity because God chose to become incarnate in it. Art has to be anchored on the physical world because the physical world is where this divine meaning lies. The divine meaning doesn't lie in abstraction. It lies right in front of us because God chose to be incarnate in it. Art should be anchored on the physical world. For Lafarge, and this is kind of perceptive of him, I think, abstraction is not transcendence, but it's the submission of all else to the bare creative means of the maker. So for Lafarge, abstraction, well, like I just said, it's not about casting your mind up toward the music of the spheres. What it really is about taking the means of the artist, line, color, brushstroke, stuff like that, and just experimenting with those. It's about taking the means and making them the end, which for him was an interesting thing to do, but it actually fundamentally limited what art is. It limited art to a small kind of sphere of experimentation. And so I have this quote from Lafarge where he says, kind of meanderingly, that there is this danger, though none of us would like to avoid it, of so much knowledge in certain matters which can be used in artistic representation that they are assumed to be the objects of artistic representation. So yes, line, color, those are the means. Maybe we get so good at manipulating them that we think they should be the object of representation, but they probably actually shouldn't. They're things that we can experiment with, but fundamentally art needs to represent something that's outside of itself. So kind of an anti-modern stance to take, but that's what he believed. And I say that this was kind of perceptive because I think it is true. There's a stream of critical thought in 20th century art that is indeed what abstract artists were trying to do as they were experimenting with means. And that was the thrust of art, and especially in the middle 20th century, was to kind of get at this idea of pure painting where the means do become the end. Another tenet, because art is the communication of existential knowledge rather than free creative action, it has to accommodate itself to its audience. It has to reach out and embrace ways that people already know. It's kind of long. I'll try to explain it. There's this great quote from John Lafarge here, where I love this, where he says in his letters from Japan, because Lafarge traveled in Japan, he traveled quite widely, but he writes that the artist has expressed the needs of others who have been looking in the same ways and yet have no voice. The artist has expressed the needs of others who have been looking in the same ways and yet have no voice. And I really like that because, a couple of reasons. First of all, right around the beginning of our period in the late 19th century, when art is kind of starting to get sort of weird, this growing sense, this mythology of the artist kind of emerges, where the artist is now considered to be someone who's like this rarefied genius who can kind of see things that other people can't see. And if you don't understand the artist's work, that's kind of your fault. But the artist is a genius who sees things that other people can't see. What Lafarge is trying to say here is that artists see exactly what other people see, and other people see exactly what artists see. Because everyone, we look in the same ways. The artist expresses the needs of others who have been looking in the same ways. So there's this sense, I guess, for Lafarge, that anyone who's kind of existentially open and humble before reality, all good-hearted people, you could sort of say, everyone who's humble before reality, like I said, we all kind of see the same things. We all see this deep truth. And we all react to it according to our vocations. So all we can do in the world is really try to be open to this deep truth. We all react to it according to how we're made, according to our skill. The artist's particular skill in reacting to the deep meanings of things is to manifest that knowledge visually. So the artist has the privilege of manifesting this knowledge visually, but all of us can have this knowledge if only we're open to it. And so what happens to the artwork then, the very important function of the artwork, is to serve as this locus, this place that all the open, good-hearted people, again, can come around and point to and say, yes, this is what I have seen, this is what I recognize. You, the artist, have done this, you've put this before us to kind of affirm that all of us have had this kind of subjective experience of this deep truth that we've treasured in our hearts, and now we see that other people have this deep experience too, because the artist has shown us that, yes, this is a universal experience. So the artist meets the needs of others who have been looking in the same ways and yet has no voice. The artist has the voice, but everyone is looking in the same way. Everyone who's sufficiently open, that is. And this actually resonates really nicely with the thought of the theologian David Tracy, who's also a Catholic theologian, who looks at art as, I'm trying to remember exactly what his wording is, but art is kind of like the public disclosure of truth. It takes the subjective experience of truth and makes it public so that everyone can point to it and recognize it. The great classic art does that. It shows that truth is indeed shared, that our intuitions are shared, that other people have these deep intuitions too, and we're not alone. And then the final tenet I think that we can derive from Lafarge's position is that tradition actually, and he writes about this, tradition is a part of the knower, and it comprises the language through which the knower manifests his perception of the world. I use the his pronoun here because we're talking about Lafarge, but it could easily be her. So tradition is a part of the knower and comprises the language through which the knower manifests his perception of the world. So there's this sense, I think, for Lafarge, what he sees is this culture that's kind of been organically growing up in Europe and America for hundreds of years, and it has become embedded in kind of the thought ways, the life ways of the people who live in this culture. And it really comprises the way that Euro-Americans visually parse reality. It's just part of our heritage, part of our mental makeup, almost part of our baggage, I guess you could say, although that word kind of has a negative connotation. But it's just part of our mental makeup. And for the artist, in the quest to communicate clearly his perception of truth, the artist has, insofar as, say, the old master tradition is still a part of our mental heritage, the artist has a responsibility to honor that and to speak in a language that other people can understand. And so we have an image like this, Lafarge's Golden Age painting, which shows a female nude. And I think what Lafarge is kind of stating through this picture is that he wants to continue honoring sort of the major vocabulary words in our visual language, our inherited visual language. And kind of the major vocabulary word is the human nude, just the human figure bereft of all accessories, just the human figure standing there kind of representing God incarnate in a sense. And so this is the main vocabulary word of our visual language. This is what he's trying to honor here. And so for him, art should be fresh and interesting and authentic, But it needs to grow out of the existing tradition as well in order not to alienate the public and in order just to honor what has come before. So kind of to sum up, for John Lafarge, a faith-filled art could not be truly modern. It couldn't completely depart from the past and just strike off and do something completely different and sort of new agey, we've sort of seen. It can't be completely modern, but neither could it simply recapitulate the past, for it had to fold new insights from the oneness that we talked about earlier, the mingling of the inner being of the self with the inner being of the thing contemplated. It needs to fold new insights from oneness into a language that everyone can understand. And so, yeah, art has authentic art for the late 19th and early 20th centuries, for the turn of the 20th century, has to have these two characteristics. It needs to emerge from an authentic place of kind of existential mingling where the artist has truly seen truth, and you can see that and feel that. But it needs to, insofar as it's appropriate, participate in the existing visual language of the culture as well. And so we get things like this from Lafarge that do have these adventurous colors and painterly brushstrokes, but that also participate in kind of the traditional mythology or the traditional stories, the traditional narratives of Western culture. So we have the three wise men right here. Questions. I don't know where I totally stand on this. I wanted to throw out some questions that maybe are kind of provocative, maybe make me seem really conservative. I don't know, but you guys can think about this. So for today's artists of faith, put up here, yes, I mean, this continues. It's perfectly acceptable to explore techniques and personal languages, and that's what artists today do. And they do it in very adventurous ways, in very kind of mind-blowing ways sometimes, in very confusing ways. And I've just pulled in a couple of artworks from artists that I kind of know, young Christian artists today. Luke Alexson's Untitled right here from 2012. That's just really about juxtaposing interesting, rather odd forms with other interesting, rather odd forms and using these textured materials as well. And so this is just really about a sensory experience of unusual forms and textured materials. So it's an experimentation with materials. That's what Alexson is doing here. And then my friend Gayla Bent from Seattle has developed this extremely interesting personal language in her artwork where she takes animal forms, kind of crystalline forms, and forms from wave dynamics as well, and combines them to make these fantastical creatures. They're very beautiful, and I think they speak to something about sort of the underlying forces in reality, but they can be a bit elusive at the same time. And then I actually brought in here an image, maybe some of you recognize this, by your professor Bruce Herman here, the Virgin Mary from the Magnificat, which is much more overtly, deliberately, I think, participating in our Western visual tradition by tackling a traditional subject, doing it in a kind of monumental, dignified way that recalls the old masters. So my question at a corporate level, should Christian art reclaim the past? I don't know, should it? Should we think about fine art as being something that should address a wider Christian public? Or should it be something that's confined to collectors, home galleries, and to commercial galleries? Should fine art step out and be something part of wider church life? Or should it be more of a private or kind of commercial endeavor? I don't know, but if it should be something that operates at more of a corporate Christian level, should it try to reclaim the past in the interest of accessibility, the honoring of tradition, kind of in the way that John Lafarge might have argued. And so this, of course, leads us to other questions. Number one, and this is definitely a very good question, is Western Christian tradition still a part of our cultural makeup? I'm not sure. I think maybe all of us in the room might answer this question differently. And if we would answer it all differently, then maybe that means the answer is no. Maybe it's not still part of our cultural makeup, but I think it's worth thinking about. Is it still part of our cultural makeup? And then for some of us, number two, is that tradition too fraught with negative connotations to be an effective means of communication? And I think that might be true for some of us as well, especially people who have been historically oppressed by kind of the Christian cultural, predominantly white mainstream. And so that's something that would have to be negotiated. I think that some people might have to become reconciled to. We'd have to think about that a lot. And then another question, does adherence to a tradition stifle creativity? I think the answer to that is resoundingly no, actually. I think that you need a tradition in order to have creativity. I think tradition provides a groundwork for improvisation. I would just put my foot down and say no, adherence to a tradition does not stifle creativity at all. This image that I brought in to go with these questions, Catherine Robles Shaw's altar screen, just kind of shows an interesting combination of folk traditions. This is from New Mexico, actually, of local folk traditions with kind of an old master approach. And I think things like this are very beautiful. So I think a lot of New Mexican artisans, actually, and artists are creating some kind of interesting fusions between their local folk tradition and the old master tradition. But yeah, and then, let's see. Yeah, the example of Trinity Church. This is a very thoughtful building. I mentioned that it's neo-Romanesque on the outside. And the Romanesque style was very thoughtfully chosen. H.H. Richardson saw the Romanesque as being a style that had developed in a period of flux, and that had kind of inherent in its structure a kind of flux. And so he saw it to be something that was appropriate, especially appropriate to his time period. And then we looked at the interior of the building as well, and I spoke about how Lafarge is trying to fuse this kind of modern, ambitious kind of approach to color with sort of traditionalist visual cues. And I don't know. I don't know if churches kind of in this mold, conceived of along these lines, would still be desirable today. But I think this is a very attractive and very interesting monument to contemplate. Yeah. And then I'd like to end on this slide. The divine light shines through. Toward the end of his career, John Lafarge began to favor stained glass. And I think that's because for him, partially, it was kind of lucrative for him to specialize in stained glass. Actually, at this period in his career, he could make money that way. But I think also, stained glass for him was really kind of paradigmatic of his artistic process. Because what he's done here is he's convened a bunch of beautiful lines and colors to create a beautiful image of flowers, of flowers, the kinds of flowers that he's contemplated and enjoyed and whose essences he's contacted through his kind of passive approach to reality, kind of trying to receive the essences of things. So he's made a beautiful, rich image here. But behind that image, light shines. And this light, I think, for him is kind of representative of this inner essence of things that he's trying to capture. And so in a way, stained glass, the medium of stained glass, helps us read, helps us understand what Lafarge is trying to get at through his theories. That, yes, there is the empirical, there's the optical, there are the appearances, but there's also always kind of a divine light shining through, and that's what the artist tries to approach. And so I would just throw on top of that, for Lafarge, it's not only natural objects that have this divine light shining through, but all of the culture that we have made, human societies, the beautiful things that we have created in community with one another, those are kind of part of nature too, and those have divine light shining through them too. And so Lafarge, I think he wants to take it all. He wants to take the natural world, he wants to take human culture, he wants to honor all of it, and he wants to create a new art that that takes that and pushes through that and creates something new that still embraces the old, basically. And so, yeah, that's his solution. I don't know if it's a good solution for today, but I think it makes his oeuvre very interesting, and I'm happy to have had the chance to share it with you today. So thank you very much.